Hey, all you cool cats and kittens out there. My name is Jamie, and to this session, we're going to talk about WebSockets, and specifically WebSocket APIs. This talk is built around my experience and a colleague's experience of building a side project using the technology we're about to talk about. And these are kind of my favorite types of talks because they distill knowledge that we've gained over the past about 2 years in building this side application. And so I'm hoping to share that knowledge with you, save you some time, save you some headaches. So let's get into it. Now, if you have any questions after this talk, you can reach out on Twitter is the fastest way probably. I'm Jay Wright on Twitter. If you don't do the whole Twitter thing, understand. My email is jamie@brilliantfantastic.com. So if you have any questions or issues with the code in this talk, feel free to reach out. Speaking of the code, this slide deck has a lot of code in it. So if you want to get that code later or now, you can pause and use this QR code. It'll take you right to the deck. It's also on speakerdeck.com/jwright. You can go there. This is the first time I've used a QR code for something helpful, so thanks for using it. Okay, so let me give you some background about where this talk came from and the origins of the information we learned for this talk. So like I mentioned, we're building an application, and the application we're building is it's an enhanced Pomodoro timer. Now, if you're not familiar with the Pomodoro timer, a Pomodoro timer facilitates the ability to do the Pomodoro technique. And the Pomodoro technique is a way to work where you focus. You have focus work for 25 minutes, followed by a 5 minute break, where you're supposed to get up from your desk, your surroundings, kind of refresh yourself, and then get back at it. This is a way I've worked for a decade plus. It's a way that I need to work. And so I've tried all the Pomodoro timers that there are in the app stores, physical timers, and there's a lot. But there's a few features that my friend and I wanted to build. We wanted to make this for the past 7-8 years. Nobody's built it, so we've decided to build it. And through the building of this, we realized that we needed to create this WebSocket API, which we are going to get into. The application, if you're interested in Pomodoro technique like I am, it's called Chronic. It's at chronic.io. It's called that right now, unless Dr. Dre or the marijuana industry sues us. And this is what it looks like. Well, this is what it looked like in the earlier days. And the reason it looks like this, like it's not really finished, is because we wanted to build this as an API-first application. We wanted to build the API, and we wanted to get that right because it was going to be public. It's going to be a public API, and it needed to work in multiple different clients, which we'll get to. And so we kind of just had this as like a test harness, this web app as like a test harness to plug in our API to make sure like the workflows were right, we're architecting it right, the messages were correct. And this application has a few distinct features that required us to use a WebSocket API. One of the features we wanted to build was that we wanted this application to be everywhere, right? We want to create Mac apps, iPhone apps, Android apps, a Slack app, an Amazon Echo app, a Watch app. It's probably the worst idea ever, but we wanted to do it. And in order to do that, we needed to make the clients really dumb. And so our idea was to create the timer on the server. So that's what we did. The server is the gold copy. The server is actually the timer. We're not starting a timer on one client and syncing it over iCloud or other ways that other Pomodoro apps do. It's a true sync in the fact that you can hold your iPhone up to the Mac app and you can see the time changing the exact same time. And that's really, really nice. Because then the server can push the events to the clients, and then the clients just simply display what the payload says that they need to display. And then that way we can make the clients very simple and very dumb. The other major feature that we wanted to build is this idea of integrations. And we wanted a lot of integrations that do a lot of different things. Examples of some of the integrations we want is we have this idea of a break time, right? So you're on your break, you get off away from your desk, and maybe you want to read Twitter, or maybe you want to read Reddit, or maybe you want to read a book, or listen to a book on Audible, or maybe you wanted to watch a YouTube video where you left off. Things like that, right? So we're calling this break time. So these events need to fire so that it can communicate with these other services. And we wanted to restrict those down to an event at every second. So our application needed to be able to fire events off at every second without kind of missing a beat. So it had to have really, really low latency. So let me give you a quick demo. Well, one of the events that gets fired every second is what we call the tick event. So every second, the tick event gets fired off to the client so that they can repaint what the remaining time is. And you will see this in action here. So what I have here is just the web app with the inspector down below. And I'm gonna let this play through a couple times, but what you'll be able to see is that we're not starting like a JavaScript timer and then sending that to the server. We're sending events to the server like a play, so you'll see that the event start is sent to the server. And the server then sends a started event back, which triggers our application to change the UI, right? So a timer has started, it's running, so we need to change the play button to a pause button. And then a tick event happens, and inside the payload of that tick event is the remaining time. So all this a client app has to do is just display that time in a readable fashion. So you'll see that happen in the inspector below. You don't need to really worry about the payload. Just know that that is happening. Okay, so here we hit play. It says started. Now we got a tick event, tick event, tick event, and it's just displaying that time in a readable way. So, how did we make all this possible? Well, the answer from the title, obviously, is WebSockets. So, we knew that we needed WebSockets. We had this idea of, we've heard WebSockets are good for this sort of use case. But maybe like some of you, I had no idea really what a WebSocket is. So I went out and researched it. The first thing that a WebSocket is it's a protocol. Specifically, it's a full duplex protocol. And what that means is that both sides, both the server and the client, can talk at the same time and no data gets lost in between, and they both receive the full amount of data, right? And I liken this to a phone call protocol, right? Where I can call somebody, they can talk, I can talk. We may be talking over each other, but we both can hear the full payload of our voice, right? There's no packet loss, right? If you contrast that with an HTTP connection or an HTTP protocol, this is a simplex or a simple connection. And what that means is one side, either the client or the server can talk, can chat at any time over the wire. And I liken this to a walkie-talkie mode of communication where one side talks, then the other side answers, other side talks, right? And So that's the major difference between the WebSocket protocol and the HTTP socket protocol. In December of 2011, an RFC, a request for comments, came out to that described the WebSocket protocol. And out of that, we got the W3C spec, which happened in September of 2012. Originally, it was part of the HTML5 spec, but the HTML5 spec grew and grew and grew. And so WebSockets were taken out into their own spec. And from that spec, we've got some browser extensions. These are built into the browser, so you can any major browser now can create this WebSocket object, as you can see here. And this WebSocket object, you pass it a WebSocket URL. And a WebSocket URL looks just like a regular URL you would type into your browser, except that the protocol is specified as WS or WSS, similar to HTTP and HTTPS. So you can have secure connections over WebSockets. Additionally, three callback functions were also created. An unopen, so that the that is called when the connection is open, either from the client. And then onClose is fired off when the connection is closed by the server. And you can handle that. And then the kind of the meat of the whole API is the onMessage. So anytime you receive data from the server, this onMessage callback is called. And the event that gets passed in, the event object, contains the data, you know, which contains the payload of the message that was sent. And then there's two other functions, a send function where the client can send some data across the wire to the server, and then a close connection where the client can initialize the close event. And that's it. It's very simple, but it's very, very powerful. And the cool thing with a WebSocket is that it starts with an HTTP handshake, right? So the client sends to the server, it sends a GET request with a header of a key of upgrade and the value of WebSocket. It also sends some other stuff like the version of WebSockets it's using and any other additional protocols it needs for that WebSocket. When the server gets that HTTP request, it sends back to the client an HTTP 101 switching protocols. The status is 101, and with two other headers, an upgrade and a connection header for that. That's if everything is kosher. If the server can't respond to WebSockets or doesn't support the version or doesn't have one of the protocols, it will return a 400 and never switch protocols. So what happens, and this is the best slide of the whole deck, so it only goes downhill from here, is over the same pipe, it starts out as HTTP and then switches to WebSockets protocol, which is really, really cool. That's how it gets around firewalls. That's how the user doesn't need to install any additional software in their browser. It just all works because it starts over HTTP. So, why do we choose WebSockets? I alluded to a lot of this before, but the major reason was because it's real time. It's fast. You get fast communication between the client and the server, and you can consistently send and receive information in under a second, which is what we needed. The other cool thing that WebSockets is it's eventful, right? It's not procedural. You're not sending an HTTP request, awaiting it, and handling it, right? You get an event that happens that says, hey, the server wants you to know something, and you need to handle it. And that's really cool. That fits into the JavaScript architecture of building applications. And in our case, it also fits into the server side, eventful functional programming that is Phoenix, which we'll get into. And we'll get into it right now. So Phoenix, for those, so now we're talking about server side. So this is the friends part of JavaScript and friends. Phoenix is the MVC framework. It's built in Elixir. It's similar to like the Rails. Phoenix is to Elixir as Rails is to Ruby, or that Django is to Python, or that Express is to Node, right? It's the MVC framework. And the reason we chose this was the main reason. Well, I wouldn't say the main reason, but a very, very high priority reason is because in Phoenix, WebSockets are a first class citizen. So when you create a Phoenix project, you get WebSocket handlers to help you out. You get testing facilities to help test WebSockets. I think like in the 10th or very early in the commit, in the commits, WebSockets were integrated into Phoenix, and since then, they've stuck with WebSockets. It's very, very nice. The other thing is it's built in Elixir, and it's Elixir is it's a newer language. It comes from José Valim, who built it, started building it around, I think, 8 years ago, I want to say. And José came from the Ruby community, and he saw what was kind of going on with the number of cores and machines and parallel handling of applications, right? And one programming language that handles this really well is Erlang. And Erlang's an older language. It's a couple decades old. And it was built by Ericsson to handle communications. So Elixir has a lot of communication industry type features in it. One of the features is hot code reloading, which is amazing, right? So hot code reloading in Erlang allows you to deploy code without your application ever going down. And this was needed, right, for communication systems. The communication system cannot go down. You can't lose your phone call. You can't lose those text messages. They can't be failed to send all the time when you want to deploy new code. And that was intriguing to us because we don't want anybody's timers to stop or reset or get lost because we just deployed some code. So that's very attractive. The other thing about Elixir is it's a functional language, which may sound scary, but it's the way that it only took, for example, a little bit of time of working with the language to kind of get some of the functional components of that down. And if you're not familiar with Elixir, that's completely fine. I'm going to explain some of the syntax and logic and stuff. And because it's functional and because it's built on the Erlang VM, it is super fast. And me coming from the Ruby world, I really appreciate that. And the other cool thing that comes along with Erlang is this OTP library, which stands for Open Telecom Protocol, I believe. And what that is basically a way to create tiny little processes in Erlang that can talk to each other and they can hold state. And everything in Elixir and Erlang is a process, pretty much. So an example is when you run tests in Elixir. Those tests are run in an OTP process that holds the state of those tests. When you connect to a WebSocket in Phoenix, that WebSocket connection is an OTP process that holds the state of that socket, that WebSocket. If you send a request to Phoenix, that creates an OTP process that holds that state. So these are very, very powerful. And when we thought about it, each timer, each individual user's timer could be a OTP process. And that OTP process can hold state. So there's no need for us to go to the database to get the state of the timer, to get what the, we don't have to like send it off to Redis or another key value store. It can just hold all at state within the OTP process. And when you deploy the code, those OTP processes do not go down. So that state stays around. It's a very, very nice system. And we'll see some of that code later. And WebSocket APIs are not new, right? They've been around for a couple years. We took some inspiration from some of them, one of them being the Slack API. So Slack has an API called real-time messaging that basically allows you to open a WebSocket connection to Slack servers. So your application is the client and Slack servers are the servers, and you can get you can send messages back and forth in channels. You can receive events that happen. So if you get a message or they change the name of their profile, or there's a slew of events that you can handle on your side. And then you can also receive user presence information. So if a user leaves a channel, is inactive, things like that, you can receive events that are around that. And I highly recommend going to those, to the docs and taking a look at their API. It's really, really well done. It's really, really well documented. Another API that we came across is from a company called Stream, and it's at getstream.io. And what Stream allows you to do is they have a read-only API, WebSocket API, that allows you to receive feed events. So Stream allows you to put your own feed in your application. So think of a Twitter feed or a Facebook feed. When things change in that feed, you can update your feed in real time. It's pretty neat. Okay, so how does the API that we built work? What are some of the things that we learned from that API? Well, the first thing a user or a client needs to do is connect to our WebSocket. Brought to you by Red Bull. Okay, and the way we implemented this is it's just this part is actually an HTTP call. We're using GraphQL. If you're not familiar with GraphQL, that's fine. I'm not going to introduce it here. But GraphQL is just the structure, how you structure and call API endpoints. So we have an API endpoint where we can call the connect mutation endpoint. And what we'll get back is a token and a URL. The token, and so this is an example of the data that you would get back. The token is a unique token for that represents that user on that device, so that we can split up how we route messages based on that. And I'll get to that in a little bit. But the more important thing here is that it comes back with a URL, which is the WebSocket URL, which allows the client to take that and connect to the WebSocket. And the reason we did that is we simply just didn't hard code. We wouldn't hard code in our API docs, hey, go to this WebSocket address and hard code it in there, right? Connecting gives clients a starting point, right? And it identifies events from that single endpoint. And it's also an opportunity to authenticate. So, once the user receives that WebSocket URL, then they can use that. And we wanted it that way because we wanted to be able to control that URL instead of having clients have to hard code something into their code, because that URL could change. We could rename the product, right? Dr. Dre comes after us and says, hey, I don't have enough money. I want chronic. You can't call your application chronic. So, we would need to change that URL, which would cause all the clients and libraries that are connecting to us to have to change their URL. Also, if you ever need to expand, if you need to scale out, horizontally scale out, and you have different servers, obviously that's going to be a different URL. So it's a good idea to have an endpoint for your real-time WebSocket API that clients can start off with. So how does the client connect to our server? How does it make that call? Well, this is a very kind of common pattern in JavaScript. Here's some JavaScript code. And we have this class called Connect, and we send our query to our Connect mutation query to the GraphQL through GraphQL. We're using Apollo, but we wrap it in this GraphQL client library in case we want to swap out that library. And then when we get a response back, we pull in that token and that URL. And you can see here that we use that URL and use the WebSocket, the browser's WebSocket object, to connect to that. And then here is where we will handle all the close and the open and the on message. Okay. So that's the client. Now let's look at the server. And we're going to do some TDDing on the server, because who TDDs their JavaScript code? Just joking. So I'm going to explain some Elixir to you. Elixir, since it's functional, there is no such thing as a class, and you don't create objects, right? What you do is you kind of group functions together in modules. So up here you can see we're defining a module, and this module has a specific name, right? Ignore this. And then inside this block is where you put the body of your module, your functions. And this is using, I should explain this earlier, but Elixir comes with a testing library called XUnit. And XUnit is kind of a spec-ish, you know, RSpec type language, a type library, where it has a describe and test block. So describe, you can think of describe and test as just functions. Right, so we're describing something here, and then in here we do some setup. So I have the query specified as a string. And what you come down here, what you pass here, what you return from the setup, you can grab inside this test function. So here this con object is the connection to the server. So this comes when you install Phoenix, you get these testing libraries, and this connection represents a connection to your to the request and response. And so what we're going to do is we're going to post a GraphQL query, and since this is a functional language, you always get back a new instance of that object. And then this little special thing right here is a very special thing. I love this. This is called the pipe operator in Elixir, and basically it allows you to just chain function calls together, where it passes the result of this as the first argument here. So really this post function here takes in a connection struct, right? Applies, calls makes the request as a post, and the result of that is put back into the connection. And so this con object is the request and response. Now this connection is something from our application. We represent any user that's connected, we put them into the database so that we can grab their token, grab their URL, things like that. And what you see here is this ecto.query is, ecto, it comes with Phoenix, and that is the ORM of a Phoenix, similar to Active Record in Rails. It doesn't follow an active record type pattern. It follows like a repository pattern. And basically what you do is you pass structs to a repository that can return new instances of those structs or new structs with any change data, things like that. So what we're doing here is we're grabbing the last connection that was created, because this should have created a connection object. And we're just asserting that the token that is in the database is the same thing that the user got in their response, and that the user ID is equal to that user ID that is the current user in our GraphQL call. Okay? If you have any questions on this, please let me know. So that's the test. This is the actual implementation. So, we are using a library called Absinthe, which allows this GraphQL It implements the GraphQL spec in Elixir. And so in GraphQL world, you use these resolvers. The resolvers you can kind of think of as like controllers. And so when you call the connect mutation, we route it to this connect method here in this module. And we pull out, in Elixir you can, kind of similar to the spread operator in JavaScript, you can pull out certain keys inside of a map. So this is a map in Elixir. And here we want the current user. And here we use a case statement. And we call this private method. That's what the P is after the def. And we pass in the user ID. And basically what we do, the only thing we do here is we call create. We do pass in the user ID here. That's a mistake. So this creates the connection in the database. And it returns a tuple. And a tuple can have two or more values that get returned. This is a common pattern you'll see all over Elixir, where the first value in the tuple is kind of this atom or a symbol or whatever you have in your language. This is a symbol, so you can either say OK or error. So if this had any validation errors, this case statement would then call this anonymous function and not this anonymous function. So if everything's kosher, we just return this connection object, this connection struct, sorry. And this connection struct then goes back through absinthe and gets converted into the response, and then the client gets it. If there's an error and we get a change set, then we basically send back this validation, this payload that gets sent back to the client that indicates what errors there are. And if there's errors in the validation, it'll point those out, things like that. So this resolver is kind of, if you ever look at the absinthe library, you will see kind of similar code to this. This isn't really anything unique. Cool. So, like I said, in Phoenix, when you create a new Phoenix project, WebSockets are first-class citizens. So you get a module called User Socket, right? And it implements things from the Phoenix socket. And so this represents the WebSocket connection in Phoenix. What you can do in this is you specify your channels. We're going to talk about channels in little bits, but you can have multiple channels. And basically just this says, hey, anything that follows this pattern, use this module to handle any of those, right? And this just says, hey, we're going to use WebSocket transport. And when a user connects to a channel, it calls this connect method. We're going to get into this in the next section about channels. It's going to call this connect method, which we're passing in the token. And so all this is doing is this assign is going to assign to this token, assign to the socket this token. Remember, I said that WebSockets are basically OTP process that can hold state. So what this is basically saying is add this to the state of that WebSocket process. Okay. And then the other method that you need to, the other function you need to implement is this ID function. And this allows the WebSocket to identify the WebSocket for that user. And so how we do that is we just say, hey, it should be a socket with this specific token, which comes from the state of that socket. Okay, so speaking of channels, let's talk about channels in WebSockets. You may have seen those. They're implemented in several different WebSocket libraries, including Phoenix. And channels is just a made-up thing. It's a custom protocol. And what channels allow you to do is multiplex communication. So you can subscribe users to a channel, and then you can broadcast across that channel, and anybody that has subscribed to that channel will get that message, right? It's a way to implement publish and subscribe. And like I mentioned, it's just a made up protocol, right? But in Phoenix, it's built in. You cannot use Phoenix WebSockets without using channels. And so what that means is Phoenix actually ships with a JavaScript library that allows clients to easily connect to Phoenix servers, okay? And so let's see how this is implemented on the client side. So you would see here now, instead of this saying WebSocket, right? It's now saying socket, and it has two, it takes in two parameters. What's up with that? Socket is Phoenix JS library's implementation of a WebSocket. Basically, it just wraps the WebSocket object that comes from the browser. But it adds some additional functionality, including channels. So here we pass in the URL with the parameter token. And this is the token that we assign to that WebSocket channel that we talked about earlier. Right? And so this socket has the same methods kind of as the regular WebSocket object, but it has this channel. So when we open, when the socket is opened, we create a channel with this events colon token on it, and we call join. And so what that would do is call Phoenix's connect method that we talked, that we showed earlier, and passes in that token, right? And you can either receive an okay or an error, and you can handle that however you want to handle that, right? If you get an error or a timeout, you want to notify the user, right? You may do whatever you want on your client side. Okay. On the server side, let's do some TDD. So here again, we're in a test, and we're testing this event channel. And all this test is doing is it's creating that connection because we need that token. And we're gonna subscribe and join to that. And we're gonna just assert that that subscription and that joining was okay, which it is because this connection exists, right? If here in this test we don't create the connection, we pass in a random token, or no token at all, I think in this, oh no, we're passing in, sorry. Ah, yes, we're passing in the token as the name of the token, as the ID of the token here. And but in this case, we didn't create the connection, so here we're gonna get an error back saying, you know, we didn't get a good token, so you can't join the channel. So this is the implementation. Here is our module called event channel. This is the module that handles anything that follows the patterns of event colon followed by a token. And it's gonna call this join method. Now, here's another cool thing with Elixir. You can actually use a pattern and take out the end of what's in here. And the token, the actual token for the that was passed in will be held in this variable as well. Payload we ignore, that's why we put the underscore, and then this is the socket that the WebSocket object that gets passed along. So here we search for that token, and if that does exist, we send we get an okay, and we just say, and we just reassign that token to that socket, so it overwrites. If it's not found, we get an error, right? When it's not found, and we just return back the string unauthorized. And so that's how we implement tokens, or I'm sorry, channels in our application, right? But there's a problem in our implementation of this whole API with channels. And this is a real image I found. So how it works under this, under the hood, is that the client actually sends over the WebSocket to the server, it sends this payload that contains this topic, right? So it, and whatever we put into that topic, so this would be the events colon token, and the token might in this case be 1234. And with this event, with this weird phx underscore join, right? And then the server sends back a reply, this phx reply with the same topic with this payload that you gave it. So, and the state of that WebSocket, right? That's cool, but there's a few problems with that. There's a few problems with that. If you were to explain this into your API docs, right? This makes no sense really in the context with the rest of your API, right? We can't change how the payload of this, we can't change that this is phx underscore join, phx reply. People that are consuming your API would just be confused, right? It doesn't follow. They don't need to know that you're using Phoenix. So we wanted to get rid of this channel liability, really. And then there's a few other things that Phoenix does under the hood. Well, this is one thing that we wanted to do. We wanted to remove this setup from clients. Clients don't even need to join channels in our implementation, right? It doesn't make sense in our API. And the other thing that the Phoenix library does is it has this built-in reconnection heartbeat logic. So WebSockets get killed all the time in real life. And so there's complicated, not too complicated, but there's reconnection logic. When a WebSocket gets down, it goes down, it tries to reconnect. And the other thing that WebSockets do is they will close themselves by default if there's no messages passed within, I believe the default is 60 seconds, a minute. And so how libraries get around this, and particularly Phoenix, is that it sends like a ping message that receives a pong message back. So it has this heartbeat message. So if nothing is going over the wire within a minute, it will send a ping and a pong so that the connection does not get closed. So if we were to get rid of channels, we would have to rebuild all of that. The good thing is somebody has done this already. So if you go to that URL and you're interested in building this on the server side in Phoenix, you can get around that limitation of channels. Because as it is now, it's built into Phoenix and you have to use it. There's no way to get out of that. Okay, and we basically just copied this implementation, which kind of goes down one level to the metal. And uses a library called Cowboy. Cowboy is the request and response library that's built into Elixir that Phoenix uses. It's just an abstraction over the request and response handling of a web server. And so this implements some of those lower level Cowboy libraries. Great, so that's all of that is connecting. Let's talk about the messages that get sent. And in a WebSocket API, this is kind of the meat of the API, right? This, there is no different URLs that you have to hit, right? There's no statuses that you get back. Really, the only differentiating factor between communicating with the server and the client is the message itself. So we went with this kind of format in our messages, where we always have a two-dimensional array, and the first thing in that array is the event name, right? And we kind of went in with the event name, we kind of went with this noun, verb, and then any additional information that's needed after that, separated by a colon. So events that get initiated will have, like when I hit the pause button, that client will send a timer's paused event to the server. And anything that the server acts on that gets sent to other clients, we kind of use a past tense of the verb. So if a client hits pause, right, all the other clients that are connected for that user need to pause their timers as well, their UI. The timer is actually paused on the server, but the UIs need to know that that timer has been paused. So the server will send back a timer's paused event with a payload. We'll get into that in a little bit. And then the second part of that two-dimensional array is the event data. This is the payload. This is any information that event needs. And then we always send a timestamp, which is a Unix timestamp for every method, for every message, just in case we need to use that, log that, whatever we need to do. So these are incoming messages. These are messages coming from the client to the server. Here's an example of some JavaScript on a client. This is hooked up. This handle on start click is, you can imagine that this is hooked up to the play pause button. And so when the clicker, when the user clicks start, this method is called. And then we need the socket. The way we do that, and there's various ways to pass around this socket object, right? This web socket object that we're using, that we instantiated on connection. For example, we're using React, or we're using Redux, and storing that in Redux. But there's so many probably better ways to handle that passing around of that socket. So we need that socket to send the message of timer start, and we give it the duration in seconds. So 1500 seconds is 25 minutes. And then we give it a timestamp. And so this is what the server would receive in this case. And on the server, this is how we handle it. So this is the test. And this is some setup. So we're creating a user, we're creating a connection for that user, giving it a token, and initiating some state of the WebSocket so that we indicate that they've been authenticated. Here's the user ID and here's the token. And we have this kind of wrapper around receiving those events. And this is the state that the WebSocket should initialize with. And then here's the event that we're giving it. This should say 1500, not 1.5. And all this test is doing is asserting that the timer, the system timer, this is the timer that, this is the OTP process. We're asserting that system timer is now running, right? So when you hit start, we want to start that timer, right? And I'm going to get a little bit more into the system timer later, but this is the OTP process that is the timer that counts down the seconds. And this is how we implement it. We have this receive event that holds the state. This is the current state in the WebSocket. And this is the event that happens, and we're pulling out the duration here. Now, the other cool thing with Elixir is that you can pattern match on these on functions. So you can have another receive that takes in two parameters, a state and the payload, but this could say timers colon pause, right? And then that is the thing that would handle the pause of your timer. So it's really nice to look at all these different methods and know immediately kind of what the method does without having to call this handle start and handle pause, you know? So this is really nice. What the body of this does is we're calling systemTimer.start. We're giving it the duration that was passed in. This is the interval of when it should tick. So this is one second, you know, 1,000 milliseconds. The reason we do that is we have some testing and stuff to where we can speed up the timer and slow it down and stuff like that. This anonymous function right here, I'm going to get into what that does soon. But basically, this anonymous function is called every time the timer ticks. So let's ignore that for right now. But the other thing that this returns, all OTP processes in Elixir will return this tuple of OK with the PID, the process ID. This is the ID that identifies that process that's running in OTP. And so what we're doing is this right here is reaching into that OTP process, getting the state of that OTP process, which is what's the status? Is it running? Is it paused? Is it stopped? What's the remaining time? How many seconds are remaining? What the beginning time was? What's the duration? And an ID. And so we take that response and we take that ID and we subscribe the current user to internally we're still using channels. So internally we're using channels, but externally the API has a layer in between, right, where we don't expose those. So we are using internally channels. So we subscribe the user to this channel. And this is just the response, right? And I'll get to, this is the response that the caller gets. Okay, outgoing messages. These are messages that are coming from the server going to the client, right? And this is an example of what would may have send out is a timer started. And this is the state of that timer. You have the duration, the status, the remaining time. This should say 1500, so those should match on start. And this is the ID, which represents the PID, the process ID, but we serialize it as a GUID, whatever, however you say it. And so this is how the client, how the JavaScript handles that. It handles that in the on message. So this would get fired off on our client when it receives a message like that. We parse that message out. We know that we're going to have a two-dimensional array with the event and the payload. And then we have this giant switch statement. Not in real life, but you could do it. But we break these out into additional classes and things like that and routers. But basically, here's where we're handling the timer started event. So instead of console logging it, what we would do is change the UI to notify the user that this timer has started, right? And update the remaining time. And then on the server, I'm gonna go through this really quick, but this is receiving an event here, and we're just testing that this broadcasts a timer started event. So we're receiving a timer start event, and this assert broadcast function that's called is built into Elixir in Phoenix and the testing library of Phoenix, that we're just asserting that Phoenix has broadcasted over this channel with this payload, right? And then this test just asserts that we're receiving the correct details of the timer when we get that message. Okay, and we're knowing that it's running. We don't really care about the ID of the timestamp, and that those should say 1500 as well. And then this is how we implement it. So this is our same receive for our timer start event. And what we're doing here is we're broadcasting. This is really the only thing that's relevant here. We're broadcasting a timer started event with that response that we got. And that's how we handle starting a timer. Pretty simple. So let's review real quick. So the client sends over to the server an HTTP call. In this case, we're using GraphQL with the connect. And then the server sends back to the client the token and the URL that it needs to connect to. The client creates that WebSocket, connects to the server. And the client at some point will send a message over to the timers with the timer start. And the server will then broadcast to the connected clients the timer started event. And that's the WebSocket API. So thank you very much. Like I said, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me on Twitter or my email. And thank you very much for your time.